It's like the, is Hugh Jackman too short, too tall to play the role? It's just like, for a moment, like, what can I say? Just
you. I'm sure you thought about recasting.
I thought with them about it extensively, yeah. And then finally, after a long battle.
It's funny because I feel like this is almost a continuation of the conversation I was having with the previous director of The Wolverine, Darren Aronofsky. We were talking about his previous movie, and he was going to do this.
You're talking about Black Narcissus?
Black Narcissus, yes. He did a brilliant version of Black Narcissus that we just could not be released, Black Swan.
Yes.
I kind of am excited about doing a film where actually everyone wants to make it. And just to see what the experience is like, and see if I can do what I do in that world, you know. And it's not like I'm going to change my process. I'm going to be working with the same team, really trying to do something very, very different.
And he was about to go off and do The Wolverine, and then he wasn't doing The Wolverine.
Well, I don't think he was about to go off and do it. I think But I think he was about to wade into working on it. But I don't know much about that story other than I checked in with him when it came to me and kind of was curious about his experiences on it. But the critical thing for me was having a point of view about the project myself. You're more aware of that than ever with projects like this, because you just feel the weight of making a product if you don't somehow have something to say with it. You feel the weight of a product in the negative, nothing more than a product. And when I came on, it was enough, it was still wet. There wasn't like a movie there as far as I was concerned. I don't think Darren really got a chance to wade in. Mm-hmm. And I was very skeptical, but what hit me about it that was fascinating was the chance to do something smaller with large scale characters, and to do that there was this contradictory nature, and that the idea of going to Japan, mm-hmm. which fascinated me in almost a more vain way, in almost a more, as a huge Japanese film fan, and as a, it just provided the opportunity to think about how often would that come up, that you get a chance to make a film in Japan, and so filled with Japanese actors, Japanese characters, speaking Japanese we can get to, that was undetermined. But for me, there was a kind of shield that the change in location provided to do something different, without rebooting in the standard way you reboot a franchise. It just allowed you to kind of think differently from the very beginning about what was driving, about the genre of the movie itself.
So does the first call come from Tom Rothman? I mean, does he call up and pitch you a movie, or?
The first calls came from Emma and Hugh. And then I spoke with Hugh extensively, and then I met with Tom and Emma. Yeah. I literally, when I went in to meet Emma the first time and she handed me the script, I was trying to talk to her about two other things. I was kind of taking the script with extreme leeriness. Leeriness about just what these kind of movies are politically at a studio, leeriness about the legacy. You have so many pictures now involving this universe. Leeriness certainly about following Darren and all the kind of like knowing that no matter what my body of work is at this point, there's going to be a certain segment of fanboys that are going to just be grieving from the moment I arrive till the moment I finish, no matter what I do. Mm-hmm. And so you kind of you're aware of all of that. And so, but nonetheless, I sat down and I read it, and what I was compelled to think about, beyond all the surface stuff I talked already about the world of Japan and making a film that would be imbued aesthetically with all that stuff, was the fact that there were the bones of a genre movie, and I don't mean a comic, I don't even think comic book movie is a genre. Maybe it is. If it is, I'm not sure what it means. I was just having a discussion with some friends about this morning, and it's like, because it meant different things in the past than it's mm-hmm. come to mean now. And there's a good debate, as a side point, about whether what comic book movie has come to mean is the result of developments in visual effects, or it's a result of demands from audiences. Mm-hmm. But we can talk about that later.
Do you think movies have anything to do with demands from audiences ever?
Do I think movies have anything to do with a demand from audiences?
Yeah.
Yes.
Who knows? Who can...
I think there's a dialogue that's going on. I think that I mean, look, I have the same skepticism you do about whether... well, first of all, there is no uniform person. There is no homogenized person. Everyone you meet is different. So what they want from a movie is different. It's part of what's beautiful about movies and beautiful about humanity. But there are some things that people are drawn to, and the business tries to learn lessons from those things. I remain very skeptical about them. I mean, when I came onto this film, it certainly would be very in vogue to make the largest possible movie you could with the largest possible scope, stakes, and this would run counter to that. But I don't have the desire mm-hmm. to kind of wade in to what I think is kind of a, for me, and I'm not saying it's for others, is kind of a cheated stakes, which is that when you make the world at stake in a movie, mm-hmm. You're putting your audience in peril, and it's a kind of cheat, meaning, well, you may not care about the characters, but if they fail, you die. So that there's some level where I feel like that's inherently, like even in the Donner, Benton Newman Superman, mm-hmm. Even at the end when he's flying around the world, he's doing it to get to the woman he loves.
Right.
You know, it's not really about California.
Yeah.
And that to me is what I miss. Now it's more like about saving California than it is about anyone particular yeah. you care about. And I think that that's essentially, I'm wandering, I'm digressing.
Well, it's interesting because I always think that it's not, I mean, are there a lot of things I love about, say, Pacific Rim? I don't want to make you say
I haven't seen it. I haven't seen it, so
I can't. It's interesting because it's like the world is in stake, and yet part of it is that the world is at stake so often now that I think as audiences we don't even think of the world really being, you know, it's not personal. It's lost that personal thing, and there's something much more intimate somehow about a couple, you know, or individuals that have...
Yeah, and you can't generalize. I mean, that the world can be a metaphor for a home. Anything,
right.
the skills of a filmmaker, the skills of the actors involved, the skills and the passion inside the writing can all make something large in scope, feel small in scope, yeah. and vice versa. I think that's where you're questioning, and I think it's interesting, which is that no, you can't know what an audience wants because it's always one single at bat. You know, mm-hmm. it's like when people prognosticate about the NFL and there's only 16 games and the whole season is rife with injuries and wind and snow, and it's very hard to actually mm-hmm. make good statistical analysis about stuff that occur. You know, you have 5 to 8 large-scale movies that come out like this summer, mm-hmm. and the journalists try to construct a theme and a lesson for the business from them, and I'm not sure that it's really coming from the tea leaves of what the public is saying or whether it's coming from other things. I mean, the public could be getting exhausted with tentpoles in theaters because they're having them at home on cable. There could be a million reasons
right.
or it could be also that they're unsatisfying, or it could be that the whole comic book thing is actually reaching a kind of wall. It could be any one of these things. We don't know.
Or it could just be that they're not being sold in a way that appeals to everyone.
I mean, right, like, you could have one bad marketing campaign, one on one picture, one ill-conceived, but that the whole world of film journalism, biz journalism, pop film journalism, is such a mess, frankly, because it's, for instance, no one ever talks, like people will talk about domestic gross, but not international gross,
right.
as if it matters. It would be like taking ball games, talking about ball games, and yet the headline is what they scored in the first 3 innings and not mm-hmm. in 9. It's kind of irrational,
yeah.
Especially if you're actually posing the discussion as a business discussion.
Well, there's still this rationalization that somehow we drive international business, which is no longer really true, and that they make a movie thinking about domestic gross without thinking about international.
Like, well, it would be like saying they made movies without thinking about DVDs before.
Right. Well, you couldn't greenlight a $150 million movie ever without thinking about international and or home entertainment or anything else. I mean,
you couldn't. And then the same goes, though, equally for the way people judge story elements and the way people judge, it's just, there's a kind of myopic nature and a kind of horse race nature, which is geared toward calling people losers and in some way, and then kind of drawing an observation about it, which isn't all that different than ESPN or something. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's kind of just kind of a fulfillment of that. But that, I don't believe you learn from audiences that way. I do believe that when I sit with an audience and watch mm-hmm. my film, I learn from them.
Yeah.
And that I wouldn't invalidate that. And I don't think I've met a filmmaker way out on the left or right wing of kind of arty or super commercial that would say that they're not learning from a dialogue with an audience.
Oh, I think the thing about that is, I mean, and Coppola famously always tested in the 70s, Godfather, everything else. It wasn't like it was no testing. Just the cards, I guess, it became for a while so overwhelming.
That creates a snap to grid of weirdness. Like, yeah. You ask people how much they like a character, but if the character is dark or even potentially an antagonist in the film, then there's going to be things that a lot of members of the audience say they don't like that mm-hmm. are actually you don't want them to like. And so measuring likability is really complicated. There was a point many years ago when I was really hung up on testing and angry about testing because I felt like it, and I still do, I think it's very much shaped against dramas and independent films, and it creates, I would compare scores with other filmmakers, and we'd all realize just how some of our best movies got these tragic scores that we could never tell mm-hmm. other people about. And usually because bad things happen to the characters in the films, and that just drives the scores down. And if you just change those bad things that happen to the characters into better things, the scores would go up. And so...
In theory, at least.
Yeah, but then there's also, there's so many aspects of this that are interesting. One is that you can't even judge whether a film is a success or failure creatively in its first day or two, because no one's seen it. It's just whether the marketing was successful.
Yeah.
So it's a whole nother kind of interesting equation.
Or tracking being another thing that's kind of been completely abused by media in particular.
I still
now.
Don't even understand how tracking works.
And well, no, the thing is, very few people actually do.
Yeah.
So really, when you read people saying they heard this about the tracking, they're only hearing what another studio executive, who may or may not know what they're talking about,
and may even
saw
be setting the journalist up to raise expectations.
Absolutely.
Yes, so it's kind of, it's all crazy that way.
Or they brilliantly lower expectations, as they did this summer with
Thankfully,
Warzee, which was
I don't spend
genius.
A large part of my life thinking about this. I mean, you kind of just are engaged. It's usually just as a movie's winding down and one starting up that you're kind of aware of this strange environment. You're putting a movie out.
Did you test a movie like The Wolverine, like you would test another movie?
We could only test, movies that are higher profile that I've made, you test in these kind of different friends and family situations in which mm-hmm. you have Fox employees come in or friends of Fox, people the studio knows won't blog.
Right.
which definitely is not a help to the filmmaker in the sense that, I'm grateful for those people coming in and I'm grateful for their reactions, but you learn a lot more watching the movie with an audience. First of all, they won't tell the people coming to the movie for the screenings you do, the friends and family ones, mm-hmm. that they're seeing the movie they're seeing. So already you have this massively distorted group of people, because no one's going to see your film in a theater without deciding to go see your film in a theater. Mm-hmm. So it's like this kind of really distorted grouping in which you may have 30 or 40% or more of the people who would go like, I'm not a Wolverine fan and I don't like the X-Men.
Right.
So it's like, so you now, in this group of 100 people or 150 people, mm-hmm. suddenly already have 65 of them that are kind of useless to you. Mm-hmm. And except to learn how many of them you may peel off and bring back to your side. You know, if you could get them to see the movie, they'd like it. You know, that kind of thing.
So we're gone all the way past you're actually making the movie.
Well, it's almost chronological because I'm living in the release.
Yes.
So I'm living in the release of the film.
But when you all agreed to do
when
this
when I
together,
got the script and I took it home, one of the things that I realized looking at it was and wrote down for myself was these five words in the back of the script. I wrote, "Anyone I love will die," and which even became a line in the movie, but became this. I don't think Darren had conceived this movie existing in a timeline. I don't think Chris McQuarrie, when he had done the drafts. Prior to and after Darren got involved, had conceived it taking place where I did. I sat down and I read it, imagining it after everyone's movies.
Mm-hmm.
Not First Class, which hadn't come out yet, but after all the movies I had seen. so that I could because you know the Claremont Miller story begins with Logan in the woods in the Yukon, kind of wandering around, right? So I just made this jump when I read it that well, he's wandering around because everyone's dead, you know, and everyone died, killed Jean Grey, and so that explains why he's in the hinterlands, living like a Unabomber. And that wasn't the intention or where they were at with the script. In fact, there had been still a kind of amnesiac plot line in the script at that point that was playing into it with trying to still figure out who he was. That I think the script was beautiful, but my own opinion was that I've seen enough movies about guys trying to figure out who they are and looking at files and pictures, and that
you didn't want to make the Wolverine identity,
or Memento, or I mean, there's actually you could create a whole amnesiac canon, but where I was getting with it was this idea that if it took place after everything, you could make a film about someone who's lost everything. And then it started to tie into themes I really cared about and stuff outside of the Wolverine and X-Men universe that I had a lot of interest in. One was this idea of immortality, which I thought was really unexplored in the character. I mean, it was a condition of the character and an attribute of the character, but he hadn't even been called really immortal. He just kind of has the power to heal, which is being immortal in a sense. And what that meant to me, I kept thinking about how to turn that into an advantage, and I even remembered an Ebert review where he had kind of complained about the first Wolverine film and about how do you make a movie about a guy who can just heal from anything. Mm-hmm. And what started to occur to me was to somehow take the narrative, the Claremont Miller narrative, and a lot of good stuff that Chris had come up with as well, but to try and turn it into a story which is about a guy who has lost the will to live yet can't die. Because that seemed to me really, if I'm making any movie about anybody, that would be a really interesting place. Mm-hmm. And it ties into a lot of things I love. Wim Wenders' Wings of Desire, Isaac Asimov's The Bicentennial Man. There's just a lot of this idea of being trapped as an angel or an immortal and wanting out, but you can't die. And from that started tripping out what would be the themes of the other characters as I worked with Mark and Scott on the script, was you know, creating an antagonist who was facing death and didn't want it, creating a kind of female foil for him out of Mariko, who already was in distress in the Claremont Miller narrative, but to try and make it more explicit that she's a mortal who's almost wishing to die because she feels trapped. So that you have an immortal who wants to die and can't. You have a mortal who wants to die and can. You have a mortal who is about to die and doesn't want to. And then the last kind of filigree on that was the idea we had to make Yukio someone beyond the attributes she has in the existing comic book who could see death around the corner. So you kind of have, and I'm a big fan of trying to construct movies, particularly pop films, around a simple idea like that and trying, you know, I did it in Copland. I did it in where you kind of almost try to represent, not symbolically, but actually with a character, all these different points of view about whatever the moral crisis is in the film. And that started to seem really interesting to me, and then it became just a question of, are they going to let me do this? And the act of interviewing for the film and meeting with Rothman and all that became a way of testing whether they actually were interested in making the film that the material promised. And I think in some ways, me being skeptical was to my advantage also, in that I didn't want it at all costs. I don't know if anyone did, but I didn't want the gig if it wasn't going to be what I was describing, because I didn't somehow see the upside creatively for spending 2 years making a Happy Meal sales device, you know.
So, I mean, it seems to me like Tom, even though some people so hate him, which is always very strange to me how much some people hate him from the outside in, but that he's interested in doing it on a budget. You know, he wants to keep
it
tight.
Well, that's Tom. I mean, Tom wants to keep the budget tight.
So for him, but you need a lot of character to make the budget, a lower budget movie that doesn't have all the bells and whistles for the trailer work. and sell ultimately. So it's, I mean, do you feel like there was a philosophy driving?
Well, I'm grateful to Rothman. He's shown a lot of faith in me over the years, and was very supportive when we were making Walk the Line, and likewise with Night and Day, and certainly with this until his departure. And the for me, I felt like he got what the movie could be, and I think I don't want to speak for him, but I think the whole company, anyone around that world, felt the sting of the reaction to the first Wolverine movie and the kind of multiplicity of commercial goals that the movie had. I think you don't need to even criticize the movie. You can just look at the title of the movie and see that it's not sure what it is. It's got a colon in it. It's like X-Men colon Origins semicolon Wolverine. You know, it's like there's kind of this sense that it's trying to literally be six things. Yeah. And I do think the studio was brave, and I do think the studio, I think I was lucky also that they had the movie that Brian's now in production on to think about pulling together and getting going while I was doing this, so that in a way I became the kind of funky cousin to the movie they had to really worry about that was going to cost a lot more and was going to be expected to deliver more on some of the fronts that I was decidedly not delivering on, you know.
And your movie, I mean, I think there's a coda in the film, but also that the movie actually feels like they figured out how to do what Marvel did with their series of characters leading up to Avengers, that there's this kind of sense of a much more of a unified universe starting with this film than any other film they've done.
Which is funny, because I made it completely independent of thinking about any kind of I think we just tried to redirect this one character in a strong way. Mm-hmm. And I think I believe in what we did, and I believe that we took Hugh and the character in the right directions for what people were hoping for and what I wanted to see in him. And I think that the second you start to make slightly bolder decisions that differentiate your character, that bring your actor, the delivery of your actor, in a way that he's got the room and the space and the encouragement to kind of really deliver, everything starts to fall from performance and character. Everything starts to fall in place, even in ways that you wouldn't expect, like a setup for a completely different movie. Just seeing him teed up in the right way just makes you go, now I want to see that guy in that world. And I do think, but I don't think we really, I mean, we conceived of the Easter egg at the end of the film way after I wrapped. I was months in the cutting room and flew up to Montreal to direct it only a couple months ago. And it was kind of, it was much more after Brian's film had kind of really taken shape. And Simon Kinberg and he and I all talked about what we could do. My big thing was I didn't want to make a gag at the end. I didn't want any jokes. I didn't want
no ramen.
No, I mean, I don't. It's not for me to judge whether it's wrong for someone else. But for me, I'm not a huge lover of post movie scenes anyway. In the sense that they seem to me to be a kind of effort on a lot of films. I wouldn't say I'd say these. It's an effort to kind of lock them together. But that in a lot of movies, it's an effort to actually, and it is. I've seen it happen. We're on preview scores. It's another way to affect preview scores in a movie is you make a comedy. It's not that funny, but you do a lot of outtakes of your comedians at the end, and suddenly the scores go up 12 points. And so, but it doesn't, does it really affect the way people feel about the movie, or does it just make them raise the scores in Woodland Hills? I don't know.
It's the big third act save. Though it's in the fourth act.
I guess. But the studio knew what I was making, and I was shooting what I said I would do. So there was kind of, there's very little conflict on the movie, even as dailies came in. I think the only thing I did out of anxiety was with Tom, I had won a great number of arguments, and we had gotten through to production in a way that was really, we were really much in line with each other. I mean, Tom, with Tom, arguing is communicating, and you kind of get to a place where you understand each other. And I think when he's, what he's testing, some people may like it, some may not, is your own commitment to your ideas and to telling him you're wrong and this is why. And he's a very smart person, and I think that you can get through to him, and that, and he also can be right. And the only thing I kind of kept from them was I couldn't really get my head around how all these Japanese actors were going to speak English when they were alone with each other. Mm-hmm. And yet I really didn't want to have this conversation. I was having a hard enough time getting the budget down and casting it and doing everything that I really... So we just, you know, I'm halfway around the world in Australia, and we just, I just shot every scene in English and in Japanese. Hmm. And I would send Fox the English dailies, and just we put a J as a prefix on all the slates for the Japanese version and just bank them.